Holy cow, so freaking pod.
Chapter
21.
Are you guys gonna high five in real life?
Oh yeah.
They high fives in real life because they're meeting in real life. But I'm not.
Hooray. Yeah. I hold all the power. I've met both of you.
Okay. I'm Cherrydoom. I'm all alone.
Oh, I'm Cherrydoom, by the way.
And I'm Chad.
All right, so this was chapter 21, and I've written a summary, and I think it's for Chad to read.
Sure.
Actually, I think it's you.
Oh, God, it's me? No. All right, I'll read.
I can do it.
No, I will take this. I will take this summary. I don't think anybody else can even read it. Anna wakes up and is startled to find Mrs. Jones, Christian's blonde housekeeper. Anna wonders for a moment whether Mrs. Jones is Christian's former sub, but then forgets about it. Upon seeing a moist Christian talk Big Papa Businessman talk and snap at Roz for the second or third time in the book. Then they fuck on the desk in Christian's study. Christian is mad at her afterwards for apparently no reason. Anastasia takes a shower. They have weird breakfast. Oh, they're gonna miss each other so much when she goes on her Georgia trip. Ooh! And by the way, Anastasia buys tickets for that in this chapter. In this very chapter. Later on, Anastasia has an interview. It seems to go well for her. She returns home and tells Kate that Kate's dumb baiting is not appreciated. So they have like an emotional friendship moment after that. Anastasia and Christian have some back and forth emails. Don't care. Later, while checking in for her flight at the airport to go to Georgia, Anna discovers that Christian magically upgraded her ticket to first class. That darn dom.
It's like that darn cat.
There's a sex summary. According to these notes, not even worth it. Christian bends Anna over his desk and bones her. They both quum. They both seem to feel bad afterwards.
Actually, he doesn't bend her over the desk. He lays her across it. They fuck face to face.
Oh, I didn't...
Yeah. Anna's head is just sort of like lolling off of the desk.
Ew. Yeah. I seem to have glossed over that for some reason. It's time for pet theories.
Okay, so Anna slowly materializes back on Earth after her orgasm, and I'm wondering if maybe she's some sort of astral traveler that gets fuel through sex. She has to have sex and then she can take journeys to other dimensions. And once she's done, she materializes back on Earth.
That sounds like a good sci-fi plot.
I heard something on a podcast that was very similar last night, and I can't remember what it was.
What podcast?
Whatever. I don't remember. That's the problem.
Oh, okay. Hey, it's Chad.
Okay. Anastasia has traveled back in time to the 90s, you know, because she... Okay, you don't know yet, because we haven't talked about the chapter. But in the chapter, she encounters a lot of bohemian-looking women, and she has an interview with a guy that's got both of his ears pierced with, like, small silver hoop earrings and a ponytail. And she describes him as wearing, like, a blue shirt and, like, I think slate chinos or something. But I think she was confused, and he was probably wearing, like, ripped jeans and a Soundgarden t-shirt. Because it sounds like it's from, like, High Fidelity or something.
Actually, he was wearing flannel gray slacks, which I thought was weird, so I remembered that.
Sure?
Yeah,
By the way, these are all people that work at the publishing company that Anna is hoping to be hired at.
Yes.
As an intern.
Seattle Independent something or other. Because I think in the print copy he's wearing chinos. Yep, he's wearing a pale blue shirt, no tie, and stone chinos in the print copy.
Isn't that strange?
What are chinos? Are they like capris for boys?
They're just
no.
Snug.
They're just like a style of slack.
Oh,
that
okay.
I don't. It's like has to do with the material. I think.
Yeah, it's the material.
They make it really easily.
Okay.
Yeah, he wears a pale blue shirt, no tie, and gray flannel trousers, in my version, which I found a little strange, for business attire. Except maybe the flannel is cut in such a way that it looks like slacks or something. So I just don't know.
It's a bohemian. They can wear whatever they want.
Whatever they want. Okay. Do you?
Anyway,
do you have a second?
You're not done, right, Chen?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I do. It's the guy she interviewed, another non-human. We haven't gotten to this yet, but...
But we will.
Anna has some sort of weird sense about this guy. She's, like, extremely uncomfortable. Can she somehow sense his inhuman nature? Is that why she's so uncomfortable?
That's a good question.
That's a good theory, but I'm pretty sure through my peeking ahead that he just turns out to be an awful villain.
Oh.
We will cover it, yes. Okay, my pet theory that I put no effort into... Christian is the sun, the main sun in a solar system, the one where everything orbits around it. Anastasia is a planet about to be sucked into him because of gravity. I have this theory because, once again, Anastasia is getting burned by the sun during sex, just like Icarus. Even though she does not say just like Icarus, I have a feeling that it's just like Icarus.
So
or the moth
in a flame. Yes, one of those things. No, but she specifically says burned by the sun.
That's true.
So what you're saying is that Christian has achieved what Solaire never could.
Yes, he has become his own sun. Oh God! Oh no! I have something in my throat. Mechanics.
That's not. I hope that's not what you have in your throat.
No, well, it came out. It just came out, and I think I'm all right now. So why don't we talk about this thing I coughed up?
So at the very beginning of the chapter, Anastasia is thinking to herself when she wakes up from, I don't know, sleeping or something. I don't know what people do. I lie back for a moment, staring through the windows, the lofty vista of Seattle's skyline. And I actually put a comma in there as I was speaking, but there's no comma in the text between moment and staring, so it really reads like, I lie back for a moment staring through the windows at the lofty vista of Seattle's skyline. At least, in my opinion, there should be a pause there.
Like, I agree.
Yeah, it's not... I agree with you. I wouldn't say that this is, like, the wrongest thing ever, but I think there should be comma there. Here we go. He really is trying. Hard. Okay, so he really is trying, comma, hard. Just no. She does this with other things, like ASAC, hard. And it's kind of okay there, but right here, it's really not okay. For some reason that I can't really qualify, it's not, this simply is not a sentence that I'll allow.
I mean, it does change the feel of the sentence, like, he really is trying hard, or he really is trying hard.
The comma makes it sound like he has a boner.
Yeah.
what is hard in this case? It's like an adverb? Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I don't like this. I think I need a linguist to tell me what's wrong with this. Okay, anyways. Here's a big quote. It's a big pile of trash. Yet he's so unpredictably and disarmingly agreeable too. He can be tender, good-humored, even sweet. And when he is, it's so left field and unexpected. He insisted on accompanying me all the way down to my car in the garage. Jeez, I'm only going for a few days. He's acting like I'm going for weeks. He keeps me on the back foot permanently. Wait, alright, I need to find... Okay. And when he is, comma, it's so left field and unexpected. And then... Jeez, I'm only going for a few days, comma. He's acting like I'm going for weeks. Jeez, comma, I'm only going for a few days, comma. He's acting like I'm going for weeks. I get that when you're having a monologue, that might be okay to do. But this is... It kind of... A lot of it just reads so fragmented. She starts the sentence with and. She also starts a sentence with yet, which I don't really like. I mean, maybe I say but instead, but it's the same thing. I don't know, and I don't know what keep me on the back foot permanently. I don't know what that means either. I suspect maybe...
I think that means, like, she's off balance, and she's, like, bracing herself for the back foot.
That's weird.
Or...
Am I dumb?
Like, she's putting her weight on her back foot because she's... Backing up with fear?
Right, like he's backing her up and she's like, and balancing.
I don't think that's what it says in our versions, but I'm not sure where that is.
I would like to know.
He always keeps me off balance. That's what it says in our copy.
So that's probably what it means. But I wonder why. Is that like a thing that people say? Is it like an age problem where maybe they used to say that and I don't know what that is because I'm from a different generation?
It might be British.
I wonder if it is.
Maybe E.L. James has done some sort of martial arts. Maybe she's some sort of samurai ninja knight warrior.
Put your weight on the back foot! Okay. My flight is booked. My mother is in seventh heaven that I'm visiting. Semicolon. I am packed and Kate has a dream. No! Wait! Start over! My flight is booked, semicolon. My mother's in seventh heaven that I am visiting, semicolon. I am packed, comma, and Kate has agreed to drive me to the airport. I'm almost certain that's not how you use semicolons twice
in a row.
It's
different in our version, okay. I'm pretty sure. Let me try to find it.
Semicolons are a little weird. They're a type of punctuation that you can use for kind of anything, even though there are... Like,
well, but really what I would have done here is my flight is booked, period. My mother's in seventh heaven that I'm visiting. Maybe period or comma. I maybe wouldn't include I am packed, but if she has to have it, I'm packed and ready to go, and Kate has agreed to drive me to the airport. No comma in that sentence, just separate sentences.
In ours, it's all commas, no semicolons.
All commas. I mean, that's bad too. My flight is booked. I'm packed.
Yeah.
It just needs an editor. I suspect and would like to mention before this becomes like a really big thing, because it will in two examples, that this chapter in my version is the least edited of all the chapters I've read, and I cannot understand, like, it's so bad. Alright, so here, there's two more, and I'm gonna say them. We haven't been doing much talking lately. I flush. Other stuff. Nonverbal communication. And that's okay. Well, much more than okay. Okay, that is other stuff, period. That's the sentence. Other stuff. The next sentence. Nonverbal communication, and that's okay. Nonverbal communication, and that's okay. Ugh, I don't understand. And then the last and the best thing that I've ever found in this book. I climb into my Audi A3 and head back to the apartment, though I take me time. I take me time.
I'm pretty sure that's correct in our
in
copy.
In the Audi!
Because I would have caught that. Storms of ruin. Taking me time with the Audi.
Taking me time with me Audi A3 to me apartment.
I roll up the windows and prepare to set sail.
Batten down the power windows.
Now it's time for Americans. And I found so fucking many. And I don't know if I was right about all of them, but I think that I'm right. So let's go. Let's do it, Charity.
The subconscious says, yes, that would be all the sex then. Because Anna's feeling stiff and she doesn't know why. Mm. And then the subconscious supplies the answer. Just adding then to the end of that is very British. Also, that would be maybe also British.
Yeah. Well, maybe not that. Or
maybe not.
In American, I would say that'd be all the sex. Yeah. Or something. Not that would be all the sex then. But that could just be not knowing how to use contractions when people are speaking on the author's part. I'm afraid you have me at a disadvantage, says Anastasia to Mrs. Jones when Mrs. Jones knows her name. I know what this means, but I don't think that Americans really say that. That's like a little... If anything, it's a bit like not casual language.
I feel like it's said much more in movies and stuff.
Yeah, like...
than real life.
James Bond might say this, but he's British.
True.
Or he tends to be. Okay.
I haven't bothered with a suitcase, just a smart rucksack that's like double British.
Yeah, smart. For stylish.
And a rucksack.
You know, rucksack. Okay. In response to, do you want some breakfast? Just some tea would be lovely, thank you. Can you make me a cup of tea? Can I have a cup of tea, please? No, just some tea would be lovely, thank you.
Have you bought your air ticket?
Instead of plane ticket?
Yeah. Nope.
The airport thing, in general, is really funny.
Yes. I suggest you go and have your shower, or I shall lay you across my desk. Now. I shall lay you across my desk is not American.
Yep.
I shall not.
That's un-American.
Un-American.
Kate says, that'll be the sexing! When Anna's implying that she's been having sex with Christian.
Barfo, as your note says.
Barfo. Yeah. It's the worst.
Ew, I don't want to read this whole sentence, but I have to. Come on, baby! Give it up for me! He cajoles through gritted teeth, and the fervent need in his voice, the strain sends me over the edge. So, fervent need. Fervent need. That sounds very... it just sounds like Britlit. Romance.
Yeah,
I think that's not something that in my internal monologue I would say, oh, my boyfriend's like drilling me with fervent need again.
Man, you've got a lot of these. I didn't see
all these. Oh, yeah. I mean, I told you I have a lot.
Also, the way you said give it up for me made it sound like he was asking Anna to cheer for him.
Yeah.
Give it up!
Charles, can you sing that first part again that he says to the tune of Come On Over, Christina Aguilera's Come On
Come
Over?
Come on, baby! Give it up for me. He cajoles through gritted teeth. Okay, it's your turn now.
Anna thinks to herself, he seems very keen.
Yep. Keen.
That's extremely British. We don't use keen that way.
Mm-mm. We only say keen when we're talking about Commander Keen.
Exactly.
Charles, British blabber bonanza. It starts now. As ever, I'm surprised by you, Miss Steele. Interviews seem such artificial situations. Everyone is on their best behavior, trying desperately to hide behind a professional facade. Did my face fit? I shall have to wait and see. She glazes at me. Kate gazes at me with pursed lips and narrowed eyes, rather like my subconscious. All she needs is the half moon specs. Incidentally, will you please stop winding Christian up? Of course, incidentally, I don't think that's very American. I know that we can say it. but combined with all the other things, I think that it's pretty British. Anna, anyone can see that, and he's fallen for you. He's mad about you. We don't say that we're mad about people when we like them.
That's not true. In fact, there was a TV show called Mad About
You. Of course, but like, to say casually, like,
sorry, I sniped that.
Like, but like, if a guy's scoping out my friend's booty, I wouldn't say like, oh, he's mad about you, darling. I'd say like, he's,
yeah, I mean, this is a thing where, you know, people are mad. They use it as crazy more than they do the word crazy, and we just think of it as angry. So it's a bit confusing sometimes.
Uh-huh, I agree. Okay, last one. He seems to have woken up and is beaming at me like I'm the Christmas fairy and the Easter bunny rolled into one. What is the Christmas fairy?
In our version, it's Santa Claus.
Okay, well,
I've never heard of the Christmas fairy, though.
I think that requires a little research. I don't know, I should maybe not have assumed that it was an English or British thing, but I feel that it is.
I mean, it seems like it is, yeah, if it was edited.
Okay, well, there you go. I hope that you're satisfied, because I found more in this one episode than I've found in my entire life.
Wording! She's talking about how a Christian lives here, surrounded by beautiful, precious works of art. And, I mean, they haven't mentioned any art in a while, so what is she talking about? Just like the black and white photos that she mentioned when she very first came here?
We have to discuss, like, what the word precious means. If you can get a black and white photo anywhere.
Yeah. Well, maybe they're original.
Original of you can something.
Take your own photos, in fact, in black and white.
But that doesn't make them precious, objectively.
Well, Anna's not exactly objective.
Okay,
what does she really know about art? Aside from her, like, sort of out-of-place comment about pre-Raphaelite hair.
Okay, yes.
What? And I guess there's that painting of the ocean over his bed, but that's really all we've heard of.
There's no way that's... Okay, sorry. It's not time for me to get artist snobby in here.
Wait, the black and white... Did she mention black and white photos with those in his office?
That might be true.
Gray Holdings?
Like, I could have sworn that she had something... That he had something similar in his apartment. Hmm. I don't really want
to. She keeps referring to it as, like, an art museum, but...
Yeah.
We haven't actually gotten any description
it
about
contents. Seems like
contents.
It's an art museum with no installations.
So just a room.
Yeah.
I sort of wish it was all, like, the furniture and the milk bar and Clockwork Orange.
Yeah.
And with those, like, horrible, giant, colorful wigs, and Anna was like, oh, this is so precious.
Is so artful.
Anyway.
It's Chad's turn.
It's shit or bust time. Christian says this in a phone call, a business phone call. But, like, what does this mean? Obviously it's being used as, like, make or break time, but, like, I've never
it's
heard this phrase
before.
Shit
or bust time?
And these both sound like bad outcomes to me.
Yeah.
It sounds like shitting and busting are maybe the same thing.
Yeah.
Okay, now, this might be a little gross, okay, but is it about, you know, you gotta poop or else you're gonna get constipated and your intestines will bust?
Oh, that's terrible.
Maybe...
But who would understand that? Like, who is he talking to that, like, is he just communicating
with
his secretary enough that she knows?
He's talking to
Roz. He's giving Roz some health advice.
Roz.
You have
more fiber. It's shit or bust time.
Maybe it's like either have a bowel movement or just fart. Alright, let's not talk about this anymore.
I am in Christian Grey's vast bed, minus one Christian Grey. Luckily, there are plenty of spare Christian Greys.
Yeah. Remember in that hostage situation we described, where he was just joking, and there were, like at least 10 Christians in baklavas?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or balaklava.
Balaklavas.
Not the dessert.
Baklavas. Just hanging out in baklavas. And it goes to dig in. Surprise.
Surprise, it's me, wearing this baklava.
All the nuts turn like Mameshiba and they're just Christian Grey faces.
Hey!
that's the dog, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
The little dog bean.
Christ, Anna, you're so ready. I mean, I know he's probably said this before, but it doesn't stop me from hating it. Because I hate it.
Chad?
Oh, whoops. We had sex, and then he wasn't. I totally understand what the sentence is trying to say.
Okay, you gotta read what it says before that, though.
I gotta find the sentence.
Yeah, let's find it.
It more or less makes sense, but also
I can paraphrase because I sort of remember. Like, it's like, oh, he was so happy. We had sex, and then he wasn't happy anymore.
Yeah. It's like he was fine this morning, period. We had sex, dot, 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 and then he wasn't, which sounds fine. But when you're reading it, since she doesn't just... She could easily rewrite this to be like, he was fine this morning, but after we had sex, he didn't seem fine, or he wasn't all right. But it just sounds like they had sex, and then he wasn't.
Yeah, like he ceased.
He just stopped being.
He ceased to exist.
Yeah, that tripped me up, too. That was one of those parts where you just have to stop reading and take a closer look.
Next, he's so earnest, so impassioned, a zealot. The force of his plea is so unexpected and disarming. I wonder why he's feeling like this. I just can't stop thinking about like a religious zealot when I read this.
Yeah,
it's like the cult of my pussy, Anastasia, or something. Like I just
well,
it's just so unnecessary. Like you can't just say like this dude's mad horny or something. I mean,
is this the power of the inner goddess?
Perhaps. Huh. She can't strike that balance between like having something that's going to engage the reader and having something that is way too overworked. Like, or exaggerating, like, he's so unexpected also. So, it's just, yeah, that's my complaint.
After clearing the pans tactfully, she heads out of the living area. I would like to know how to tactfully clear pans.
Yeah.
Probably without a lot of sound.
That might be it.
What?
But I believe,
yeah.
I mean, what she means is that she heads to the living area tactfully.
Yeah.
Yes.
Or she tactfully heads to out of the living room, but she's made it confusing.
She exercises good tact and leaves.
Yeah.
Leaves them alone. However, at least in my, like, in my reading, I just totally put that with the first phrase. So. Mm.
I revel in his possession, his lust slaking mine. I slaked mine lust upon her bust. We have dangerous sex without much trust. The used condom in the pocket grows a crust. In this book, editing is a must. I feel like I messed that up, but okay. I just don't like this. His lust slaking mine. Like, his lust is making my lust not be hungry
it's
anymore.
Very sort of, I don't know the word, like, existential?
Sort of.
It's just sort of more metaphysical description than what she's been doing so far. I mean, maybe she's transcending the physical, but it is weird.
You know, you're having sex on a desk for basically no reason, and you're saying like, oh, he's like a cultist, and his lust is slaking mine, and like really what it is his physical attention is what's, I mean, possibly also the power dynamic, but like this is just use normal words, you dick.
So we mentioned this before. I cry out a wordless, passionate plea as I touch the sun and burn, falling all around him, falling down, back to a breathless, bright summit on Earth. And I mean, at least she's varied the Icarus thing. She's not just saying, it sure feels like I'm Icarus again.
Yeah.
Flying, you know, the guy who flew too close to the sun? That again. But yeah, I mean, so maybe she's learning?
So, Anastasia is sitting in the office of one of her interviews, waiting for her interview, and she mentions that the receptionist, every few moments, she glances up at me, away from her computer. Away from her computer to look at you.
What if Anastasia's the computer?
Oh no!
What if she has Google Glass?
She looked through the computer to look at another computer, which is me.
Yeah, she turns from the computer with all of the like work stuff on it to the computer with all of the surveillance camera stuff on
it.
A woman with long black... This is the same... No, this is a separate woman that comes in and stands next to the reception desk. A woman with long black pre-Raphaelite hair standing by the reception desk distracts me. Why is this woman's hair standing by the reception desk? How is it standing by the reception desk? These are questions we need answers.
Well, pre-Raphaelite hair is really long, so... Maybe it's also able to stand. I don't know.
Like, I'm beginning to think that this is more, like, more of an analog to the Twilight universe than we might know, where, like, hair monsters exist and stand next to, like, PR or HR people.
Did you look at my ticket yet? Can't stand this harassment. I don't know how it works. I just assume that it's, like, IT tickets, human resources ticket.
Oh, for those not unfamiliar, the pre-Raphaelite hair is, like, Raphael the... the artist, pre and post. Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay.
Google it.
Google it. Last one. I'll see you when I get back. Don't let old Moneybags grind you down. Kate calls Christian Moneybags, some iteration of Moneybags, during this chapter, and I thought that was very funny and bad. So there you go. All right. It's time for situational. Okay, so during the job interview that Anastasia goes to, everybody calls her Anna, just like from the get-go, and I'm guessing that's because she told them to call her that. To me, that seems kind of weird and unprofessional. I have a legal name, and I have a nickname that is, like, you know, for all intents and purposes, it's my name. My parents call me that, my friends call me that. But when I have a job, anytime that I've had a job in the past, I never ask people to call me by my nickname, because I just think it's, like, really goofy. Like, I mean, you should sort of, like, you know, it's like a professionalism thing. Like, I think maybe if you got really chummy with your coworkers, you could say, oh, just call me this, or whatever, but...
Yeah.
I don't even do it at school, but that's just me, but...
I mean, I think it's sort of like, if that's what you want to be called, like Anna does, she gets in a little tiff with Christian about it. It's like saying, you should call me Anna.
See, like, I used to get like that too, especially because my nickname is, for some people, very hard to pronounce. So I'd be like, don't call me longer name! Call me shorter name! And say the fucking shorter name right! But, like, I mean, but as I've gotten older, like, I realize it's not worth it. Just, like, let them call you the longer name. Everybody will be happier, and nobody will be confused. Of course, Anastasia doesn't have this problem because her short name is Anna. So whatever. Moving on. Interviews seem such artificial situations. Everyone on their best behavior trying desperately to hide behind a professional facade. Like, maybe you, Anastasia. Like, I just feel like this is something that somebody would try to say about, like, life to sound really deep. Like, they're so artificial, man. Like... It's just, like, a system we're in. Like, I'm 16, and I thought of something that I think is very original. Okay? All right.
The whole interview is like that, though, because she sits there, like, going, like, this is a place I want to work. It's not corporate. It's all quirky and, like, bohemian.
And yet she's still complaining in spite of the quirky bohemianness that it's like, oh, it's so artificial. Like, come on. Like, I mean... It's part of being an adult. You get interviews and you do well during those interviews because you need to present yourself in a good way. It's because they want to hire somebody who's not a shitty brat.
Yeah, basically.
Yes.
Sometimes they do want to hire shitty brats, though.
Yeah, sometimes they do. Okay. That said, I think in this case, they did not want a shitty brat, and they were trying to see if she was not one.
Well, surprise.
So my last sort of... my last comment about this is... Jack Hyde asks her, you have a very impressive GPA. What extracurricular activities did you indulge in at WSU? And I'm just wondering, like, is that standard for people to ask about your GPA or to see it? Like, you just
put... For some jobs, yeah.
That's
interesting. I would say for this kind of job, possibly.
Okay, what is it exactly she's doing at this job, if I can remind all of us?
Copy editing?
Yeah, probably she's either going to be a copy editor or an editorial assistant, it
sounds
like.
Would it not be more important for her to show, like, portfolio pieces rather than GPA?
Hmm.
Not for copy editing. Well, maybe.
Or just, like,
I mean,
resume,
she probably did as well.
Like, previous experience copy editing. That, to me, seems like it would be the most important thing.
Well, what's interesting to me is that she didn't already have, like, an internship completed through college.
Yeah.
I didn't do one, but a lot of people do. Especially if they want to go into, like, a professional field like this right away.
Mm-hmm.
And not necessarily that she'd work for the same people again, but that she'd have a reference from them.
Yeah.
And that's sort of why the GPA thing stuck out to me. Because normally they'd be like, so you have a good reference from such and such company.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm thinking myself.
But, yeah, some places do want to know your GPA.
Interesting. I mean, I suppose
most don't. But.
I would understand if they're, like, weeding through a bunch of graduates and it was sort of, like, a connected to the school thing, which, like, it may very well be. But, you know, James never went to that effort to explain. Okay, so the last thing about this, Anna flips out over the use of the word indulge. Like, what extracurricular activities did you indulge in at WSU? So, like, she's like, indulge. Like, why? I don't know why you would fixate on that unless, like, I do admit that it's a bit of a strange way to ask, but it's not so weird that you would be like, oh, I can't stop thinking about that. Except maybe that she's so fixated on sex and indulge has a sexual connotation. I just don't know.
Probably.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, if the guy had said something like, which extracurricular activities did you find pleasured you most?
Yeah, that sounds a lot more suspect to me than what was said.
Probably with the HR person there, that would have ended the interview right away. She would have been like, wait, I know you're my boss, but...
Perhaps you should ask me that in the spoiler dungeon.
Me.
Yeah, it's you. Yay.
The housekeeper, Mrs. Johnson, is wearing a navy blue pencil skirt. This seems like it's not the best uniform for cleaning a house, but maybe I'm...
I don't know.
I mean, you know, there were quote-unquote French maid outfits, but those had lots of...
stupid crap on.
They were so, like, flouncy, you could move your legs around, but pencil skirts, that's very thin. You wouldn't have a lot of range of motion in your legs.
My thought with this was, like, maybe there's not that much to really clean, because she... I mean, when we see her, she's cooking, which, yeah, mm-hmm. You can argue, but whatever. Cooking, you're not going to be moving your legs around too much. But I bet she's just cooking, making tea, fluffing the occasional throw pillow. Like, I think any of the hard work is probably not done during the day when people can see it, because it's like a thing of, like, oh, your house is shit, I have to clean it so hard.
The housekeeper thing is interesting, because this is more like a housekeeper in, like, the British sense.
Yeah, it very much is.
Like, Sherlock Holmes is, housekeeper.
She's not a housekeeper.
Yeah, so it's less like a cleaning person, I guess, like, we're kind of thinking of, and more like...
Yeah, we should be thinking, like,
just an old lady.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I kind of imagine the same thing, just, like, she gets there, she, like, maybe dusts a single table, and then moves a picture frame, and then, like, 3 hours later, moves the picture frame back a little bit more, just does that every once in a while.
This is just not a thing that's very evident in our culture, to have somebody, like, in the house, like... doing all your shit. Like, I mean, maybe for the upper class, like, especially taking care of kids, I think people have, like, an au pair or whatever, but, like, just for the sake of doing it and you're a single man, I do find that a little strange. Like, I don't know.
I wonder, Christian seems to, like, treat her pretty well, but I wonder how true that is. Like, we have speculated on where his used condoms go. Maybe, he, like, when he's done, he just gets home and throws them all at her. Just like, clean this up!
No!
So Christian has this conversation when Anastasia is coming into his study, and I would like somebody to read his side of the phone conversation, the Big Daddy Businessman monologue, that Christian is yelling at Roz, whoever Roz is.
I'll read it. Unless that company's P&L accrues, I'm not interested, Roz. We're not carrying dead weight. I don't need any more lame excuses. Have Marco call me. It's shit or bust time. Yes, tell Barney that the prototype looks good, though I'm not sure about the interface. No, it's just missing something. I want to meet him this afternoon to discuss. In fact, him and his team, we can brainstorm. Okay, transfer me back to Andrea.
He waits, staring out the window, master of his universe, staring down the little people below from his castle in the sky!
Andrea.
Who is Roz, and why is he getting yelled at all the time?
Maybe it's like his business vice president or something?
That's possible, yes.
It's probably his personal assistant.
I thought that was Andrea.
Oh, yeah.
That is Andrea.
Right. Maybe it's just what he calls Andrea when he needs other things done.
Roz! Andrea! Roz!
Okay, go back into Andrea mode.
Oh, look at our dominant 50 Shades of Fucked Up Master of the Universe here.
Yeah, Master of His Universe. Ha ha. Title dropping.
With one fluid movement, he clears all the plans and papers off his desk so they scatter on the floor. That'd probably be really loud. Anna wonders if Mrs. Jones would have heard them, and, well, probably. Unless his office is soundproof, which it could be.
Well, I mean, if it's just paper and not a bunch of paperweights and executive toys...
What kind of a desk does he maintain? Doesn't have a computer or a phone or anything on there?
Oh, wow.
Does it have, like, one of those little birdie dippers that dips in a cup of water?
It's got, like, the kinetic balls. The Newtonian balls.
The balls.
It's just covered in, like, marbles, and he just brushes them all off.
Anastasia, I love balls.
Anastasia, come and play with my super balls. He says as he, like, opens his... you know, nerd dungeon.
There's a bunch of super balls on the table, and he just, like throws them all off the table so they can have sex, and they're all like, boing, guys are doing it.
Come, Anastasia, let us play jacks.
Okay, so this thing about no touching has been a big deal for both of them, but what does it mean exactly? It seems like she's touching him all the time. She, like, wraps her arms around his neck and runs her... fingers through his hair. It seems like he only freaks out when she touches his chest specifically, but neither of them have mentioned no touching the chest specifically. But that seems to be, like, their understanding between each other, and I don't know how they arrived at that.
I believe that... Okay, well, I also agree that I don't know how they arrived.
I mean,
at
I know why, spoiler dungeon-wise, he doesn't like his chest touched.
Well, to me it seems like that only really happens when he's, like, not clothed. So he's just not okay with, like, a skin-skin contact there. Like,
oh.
Yeah. But he seems alright, like, with his neck and stuff and his face.
Well, but he also, there was, like, one time when she tried to touch him through his shirt and he backed off too. I think he was sleeping at the time.
Could have just been having a bad day.
Maybe, yeah.
I don't know, I mean, it just feels like...
He was
like...
having a dream, and, like, a monster was chasing him, and finally the monster caught him, and, like, was rubbing his chest centrally, and he's like, oh.
No! What a terrible dream!
I mean, if I heard no touching, I would think that he meant no touching at all.
Yeah, ever.
But, I mean, that's not the case, yeah. And I don't understand the specifics of this. It's just not explained.
Yeah, it's something that could be just explained a little better, yeah.
Maybe he's got, like, a pin or something that just has, like, a diagram of where he's touchable. And he just wears on all of his clothes.
It's almost like something like that happens later.
Oh my god.
What?
Not exactly like that, but maybe you should ask me later.
He mutters, producing a foil packet from his pants pocket while he unzips his pants. So he keeps used and unused condoms in those pockets. They just mingle together.
Ugh.
Maybe he has one pocket for each thing. Who knows?
Oh, yeah. Right. Used in the left.
Yeah.
New in the right.
Right.
Don't and get them mixed up.
Righty-tighty, lefty-loosey.
Empty packets, like, in a back pocket.
Yeah.
So this sex scene was, like, another cliche. Like, Christian sweeps all of the stuff off his desk in a fit of passion and throws Anna across it. Not necessary. She could just lay her on top of the papers. I'm sure she wouldn't get vagina juice all over it. I feel like James is just going off, checking off items on, like, a checklist of, like, things that are hot. Like, no panties, desk sex, elevator sex.
Special sex, normal sex, foot yeah. sex.
Shower sex,
BSM
sex in the bathtub.
Sex, bathtub sex, car sex.
Boat sex.
Oh, man.
Later,
those are all things that are probably going to happen.
Yeah. And I feel like it's just her trying to appeal to different readers, like things like saying, oh, that's a hot fantasy. You gotta put that in there. And just trying to jam all of these hot things in there to appeal to as many people as possible.
Yeah.
And I understand that from a fanfiction perspective, like, you wanna take these two characters that you like and then put them in all the sexy situations you can think of. But it's kind of weird sometimes if it's all, you know, in one yeah. relationship that's happening within, like, a week.
Yeah, I feel like it sort of devalues the sex a little bit. Just like, look at all the different sex! Like, it's not special, really, anymore, because your characters have already done it. They've already done, like, more extreme things before a not-so-extreme thing.
And also, I was kind of like, geez, again, when they started having sex, I was so sure they'd, like, there would just be some tension before she left to go to Georgia, but nope,
yeah,
they just fucked.
I just found it kind of boring. Like, it didn't even really warrant, like, it was so easy to just compress into, like, two sentences for the summary, just like, they fucked on a desk, and they both cummed.
I feel like the fans wouldn't stand for that.
Maybe they wouldn't. Perhaps they would not, maybe, but then again, they wouldn't stand for many
very,
things.
Very, very rarely is that sort of thing skipped over in fanfiction, I feel like. Especially amateur fanfiction.
Okay.
I mean, I guess it's all amateur, but anyway.
Maybe we're thinking about this the wrong way. Maybe this wasn't, like, included so that the checklist of, like, sex places and positions and such that they needed to, that you would need to hit normally in, like, the sort of fanfiction. Maybe that wasn't the intention. Maybe this was here specifically so we knew what sorts of things Mrs. Jones had to clean up.
Another kind of fetish. The cleaning up fetish.
Someone had sex here, that's so hot.
But all these great, like, all these great side story books we could have about, like, Mrs. Jones being like, oh, God. Dumped everything on the floor again.
Yeah, all the messes she's had to clean up after would be a story.
It's just like all of, like, Christian's help, just standing around talking about Christian, like, what an asshole.
Story
Taylor's just
ages.
Like, I dispose of this girl's Beetle. He got her a new Audi.
I just keep me in a cabinet all day. I'm lonely.
Does Mrs. Jones live in the cabinet, too?
That's a good question. We'll have to think about it.
I towel dry my hair, comb it through with Christian's one and only hair implement. But what is the hair implement? Is it a straightening iron?
No, it's obviously a comb because she's combing it through her hair. But
you could comb. She could comb like an afro pick through her hair.
No, she could comb. She would pick. Kind of comb, no, she would pick. She wouldn't comb. She's picking it. She's picking her afro.
Well, maybe she doesn't know what it is.
I think
it could be a fork.
It could be scissors.
You can comb your fingers through your hair. That's not a comb.
She could just be raking scissors through her hair. He just says hair implement.
Maybe Christian's
a shampoo bottle.
One and only hair implement is her hand. It's just multi-use. Yeah. Wow.
Whoa. He just has like her hand there at all times.
No, like it's just like a. It's like she. Like,
she does run it through his hair. Maybe that's the only way. I mean, it is like unkempt.
Yeah.
So maybe she is the only one thing that like ever touches his hair.
I think E.L. James was thinking if she had the verb comb, we would assume comb, but it's still kind of awkward. And when I think implement, I think of like a primitive tool, like a stick that you're using to get some bugs, or like
just a
rock.
Stick covered in ants that she's like rubbing on
yeah,
her head.
Exactly. She's picking out little ants that live in her brain with a stick.
Or the little ants are just made out of hair.
Yeah, hair ants.
Just little tiny hair ants on the stick.
Pick up those hair ant nits.
So where does the condom go this time? He never takes it off.
To a place where no one knows.
And then he puts his dick back in his pants.
Maybe he leaves
maybe
it
his
on.
Maybe the condom is still on. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe this is just that day. The one time a year where he's like, well, it's that time again.
God, going through all those meetings, that must be uncomfortable.
I don't know if that's really possible.
I don't think it is.
I feel like it would come off.
Well, I mean, if it's pressed against his underwear and pants, maybe not. I don't know the physics of this sort of thing, though.
Maybe he rubber bands
it gets, yeah, right. Like, so he ties it at the end, but while it's still on. That's horrible. Why are we... I wish we never talked about that. That's just,
sorry.
No, it's okay. So have this big dialogue. Christian is still nowhere to be seen, and Mrs. Jones is checking the contents of the pantry. Tea now, Miss Steele? She asks. Please. I smile at her. I feel slightly more confident now that I'm dressed. Would you like something to eat? No, thank you. Of course you'll have something to eat, Christian snaps, glowering. She likes pancakes, bacon, and eggs, Mrs. Jones. So, for context, he is not in the room until that line. He just immediately comes in and is like, no!
Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to be like a... Oh, he's appeared out of nowhere and snuck up on me to control my life again, but she doesn't, like, mention it.
Well, she says Christian's nowhere to be seen. And then she
suddenly
says
like, he shows up and she doesn't, like, comment on the fact that he's suddenly shown up.
He just popped out of the stove.
Yeah.
He's under the table.
Just one of the, like, stove grills just comes up, Christian's underneath. Of course she'll have something to eat!
Yes. Under the table, taking off her socks, like, you will! That's a really good way to annoy somebody. Chad. Yeah.
Have you bought your air ticket? No, I'll buy it when I get home. Over the internet. yeah? You gonna rush to the airport and do it?
You can.
You can call, yeah, I think you can could, call on the phone and do it.
She could call a travel agent.
Yeah.
The internet. It's so great. We're using it right now.
We're using it right now!
To do the podcast.
To make a
she didn't
pod.
Even have a computer. What if Kate was out on assignment and she had her laptop and Anna hadn't gotten the laptop from Christian? She would not be able to buy a ticket.
Nope.
Yeah.
Or I guess she would do it over the phone.
Maybe.
Like
she
an
might
old
just be confused.
Lady.
She might just lie to Christian and be like, yep, I'm in Georgia. And just make Georgia sounding sounds. So just like, I don't know. Deep fryer noises, Coke factory, Delta hub, you know.
Anna emails Christian and waits for a response. I sit and glare at the screen. I wait and wait. The response email comes about 14 minutes after she sends him an email, according to the timestamps. Did she just sit and stare at the email program for 14 minutes? Like, geez, go check Pinterest or something.
Look on Tumblr.
I mean, I feel like she might do a lot of sitting and staring.
Yeah, I think she's just there, like, just waiting for 14, 15 minutes.
Yeah.
So now we see why she is perfect for Taylor.
Everything you do interests me, says Christian. You are the most fascinating woman I know. This is from Christian's first email. Can you guys help me understand why Anastasia is so fascinating? Because I'm afraid I just don't see it.
She likes tea?
Well, it's kind of like meeting a feral child.
Oh, I see. But I just, you know, so it's like a feral child, socialized again to be human. She likes books, and she doesn't... Maybe he thinks the fact that she can't use any electronic devices is really fascinating.
Maybe.
We don't really know what he uses it for either, though. Like, because they don't really... She, E.L. James, probably because of her age. I'm stereotyping here. Mm. But, like, she probably doesn't quite know what people their age would be using the internet for. So that's why we never hear about
Christian's
them.
Christian's obviously using the internet for serious man business things to make money, okay?
Doesn't he have people to do that for him?
Yeah, but he does it also because he's very hands-on. So, like, oh. I mean, okay, but this doesn't answer the question. Anastasia is the most boring yeah. bitch. She's so boring.
She likes one book. Which isn't really that much of a... This really isn't... It's sort of a boring book.
Hmm.
I guess. I haven't read all of it.
I've read some of it, and I am inclined to think that it's also boring.
I think maybe James is just giving hope to all those boring girls out there.
She doesn't even seem to have any hobbies.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's what really gets me, is that she doesn't really have hobbies, and yet she can be the most fascinating woman that somebody knows.
Well, I also think the reason that he's saying it is that it's because she isn't that submissive. That's, like, the whole reason he partially seems to find it. Like, he was already enchanted when they met, but then every time he tries to control her, she pushes back, and he's like, wow, a woman that pushes back. Who would have thought?
Okay, sure, fine. That's a good
answer. That's what I'm getting. Like, that's how it seems to me.
I can accept that, I guess.
Anna is describing her flight plans. I'm on a red eye with a stopover in Atlanta. Like, Atlanta? I can understand that she doesn't necessarily live in Atlanta, but her mom does live in Georgia. So why wouldn't she just fly to whatever airport is closest to her mom?
Well, I mean, it might be like a tiny municipal airport, and they don't have a flight straight from Portland, Seattle, whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, that happens all the time.
It does happen.
Yeah,
a lot.
But there are other cities in Georgia. And like, what? Like, if it was a layover, I don't know. I guess I don't know.
I suppose we could do some research and see like where her mother lives. What if it's Atlanta? I'm gonna look.
Yeah. Maybe that's the stop.
I mean, because even if it is like a small municipal airport, most of those airports, like, so like not a national airport, just like a, because there aren't like local airports. The ones that work that way are like private airports.
Yeah.
That's why I'm confused. Because if
there can be municipal airports.
Yeah.
Like
okay,
Panama City
so
has
her
one.
Mother lives in Savannah, that's Georgia.
True. She lives in Savannah. Probably has an airport.
Yeah.
Savannah's a big city.
But I mean, maybe the airline she was on just didn't have a direct flight. It happens sometimes.
But then why wouldn't they have a layover before Atlanta? Because it is a nonstop flight to Atlanta.
Maybe it was like.
Well, I mean, okay.
Like that's why I'm confused. Her mom lives in Georgia.
But, okay, like, most people maybe aren't going to from Seattle to Savannah. Most people would be going to Atlanta to go to other places.
That ticket, like, today. So it's going to be a bad ticket.
Well, okay, think about it like this. Like, okay, so I flew in here.
Uh-huh.
I had a layover in Atlanta. Like, what if I had a layover in, like, Houston or something?
That happens
all
the time.
Houston is far away.
Okay. When I fly out of Texas, I usually go to Dallas.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You're wrong!
I'm just wrong. I'm sorry.
I mean, we share your frustration, but it's sort of like how the airline industry is now.
Yeah. No, I think I'm just dumb.
All right. Fashion chat? Anna's dress is a black pinafore dress with over a white blouse. This seems kind of childish to me. I guess it depends if it looks like a school uniform or not, but yeah, it seems strange. It seems very, like, cute, a twee secretary in a mumblecore movie.
Yeah.
Which I guess makes it sort of appropriate for this job.
A little bit.
So.
But she had two interviews. So, like, in the first one, she said they were, like, extremely corporate suit type people. But her comment to herself is, it's very interview, like, her outfit and her opinion. But it really only seems appropriate for the second place, so I don't entirely know. I don't know what she's thinking.
Well, here's what I think. Now, I sort of am inclined to agree with you that, like, when you... The first thing you think of when you think of a pinafore is something that's kind of childish. Okay. But it's not always like that. It's usually just referring to the fact that you're wearing a dress that has got some holes in it and you need to wear something underneath so it doesn't look like your hoe. For instance, I have linked this, mod cloth, dress into our document notes, and I'll link it, in the description when the time comes. And to me, this seems like the kind of pinafore, or jumper, or whatever you'd like to call it, that while it does, it would not look out of place at, like, a weird Catholic school, but it also wouldn't look that bad if you dressed it up with, like, a nice shirt underneath, and just wore that to, like, a job interview, or to, like, a job, like... I mean, on that site, in the reviews, it's like, oh, I wore it to the office, and I wore it to a party afterwards. I think that people used to wear a lot of this kind of dress, like, to work in, like, the olden times, whenever that is, 20s to 50s. That's a big time period. Really what she's going for is, at best, a retro and professional vibe, and at worst, a childish and weird vibe. I've been looking for... So I might just be sensitive because I like to wear this kind of thing.
I was going to say it sounded like something you might wear. Not trying to judge you or anything.
You should, by all means, judge me. But the difference between me and Anastasia is that Anastasia is a normal-sized adult, assumedly, who looks like an adult. I look like a baby, even though I'm not a real baby, so I can get away with like wearing weird stuff like that.
Okay, well, to be fair... I couldn't get away with wearing
Well, it's all about your perspective, man. If you believe you can do it, you can do it.
And I would look super gawky and weird.
No, you probably look cute, but you probably wouldn't like it very much. That's really what you have to base it on. If you think that you look good in it and you like it, you should wear it.
Yeah.
So there. Cheryl's words.
All right. Lots of talk of boho chic, and Kate says that Anna would look good in boho chic. She's like, you in boho chic? It could work.
Boho chic? Boho chic?
Let's see, Anna, you're one of the few people who could really pull that look off.
Alright, I just looked in the Google image search for this. I looked at the Google for this, and like, number one, many people have tried to wear this style, it doesn't look that bad. But number two, I hate this. I don't think that this is nice, and I don't think that people... I don't think that there's a, like, a real... like, official boho chic look, because I'm looking at this and I'm seeing a lot of different things. The thing that I would think of is, like, those, like Free People, like, hippie dresses. And that fashion makes me really mad. So mad. I just think it's not very... I think it's very, like, Seattle, I'm white, wow. White person with dreadlocks, wow. Yeah, okay. That's just what I don't know. If some boho chic princess is... listening to this podcast and starts crying, it's not my fault. You don't have to... My opinions, they really don't matter. I'm sorry. I never meant to hurt you like this. K-Chat! Speaking of Kate, a quote from Anna. I trail off. Shit, I'm talking to Foghorn Kavanaugh here. So there's no comma after shit. It should be shit, I'm talking to Foghorn Kavanaugh here. So my question is that like Foghorn Leghorn she's comparing her to? Or don't tell her secrets because she's a Foghorn and we'll tell them?
What's the sentence before this?
How she thought the guy was weird. How she thought Jack Hyde was weird.
Okay, in our copies it says, the guy who interviewed me was unnerving though. I trail off. Shit. I'm talking to Megaphone Kate Kavanaugh here. Megaphone Kavanaugh.
Okay, well that's better.
Okay, was... Megaphone...
A megaphone and a foghorn are not the same thing.
Yeah.
No.
I thought megaphone was the name of the school newspaper. Because that's the name of the school... That's the name of some school newspaper, so maybe I was just confusing it. But yeah, that's what I thought they were talking about here. But she just means
she's loud. Yeah, she just means she's loud. And the thing that gets me, too, is like, if you tell a foghorn your secrets, all the foghorn is gonna say is... But in any case, like, what's the secret? Like, a guy was weird and you didn't like it? That's it?
Yeah, apparently. She does pick up on it and is like, oh?
Ruin her professionally, because Kate works in the same business. But,
I don't think
She's really talking. What if she's really talking to Mega Upload Kavanaugh? I know that's sort of a dated reference. Mega Upload's
gone.
Yeah, but
most of us should know what that is. I would think, anyways.
Yes, Chuuurls, the one who didn't get the Baskin-Robbins reference.
You're mean.
I'm sorry.
I mean, I had been to the Baskin-Robbins. I just didn't know the famous logo. The little quirky
motto.
Thing that they say about having flavors.
Okay. Only Kate can look gorgeous in an oversized shirt, tattered jeans, and a dark blue bandana. Really? Only
so.
Kate?
Yeah, the same thought.
I think I could look gorgeous under these circumstances if I wanted to. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure many, many, many ladies
I think
could.
Even, I mean, maybe even Chad would.
I think this... I think this is just proof that, like, Anna really only knows, like, 3 people in the world.
Yeah.
And she doesn't use the internet. Like, she can't Google fashion.
Pretty girl. Show me.
He's like... Google, computer, show me, girl, fashion, pretty woman. And instead she just gets lots of pictures of Richard Gere. She's like, no.
Chad, I have a question. You know the Snuggly the Crow from Dark Souls and Dark Souls 2?
Mm-hmm.
You know how she's
yeah.
like...
Hey, I know that too.
Oh, you know that too. I'm sorry. I forgot yeah. you also like that game. Give me. Ah! Girl, give me. Ah! Beautiful.
It's just past life Anastasia.
All right.
The patented Catherine Kavanaugh radar for an interesting tidbit of information. It probably needs a better name. More concise name.
The crits?
The critty? Wait, you have to include all of it. Crifitoy.
She closes the distance between us and takes my hands. And the most un-Kate thing to do.
Sexy. but...
Apparently... Go on, Chuuurls.
No.
Okay. Shut down. Yeah, this seems to imply that Kate and Anna don't usually have much physical contact. Hugging or anything.
I don't know, they seem very affectionate with each other, but, like, there's a lot of things he says, oh, Kate doesn't do this, but we don't really have any
Kate
metric for that,
faithful.
Since
yeah.
she immediately meets...
Kate never touches
Maybe
my
Kate's
hands.
Like Christian. She just doesn't want Anna to touch her hands.
Don't touch my hands!
That's what she says, is Anna's hands are like a wine glass. She just drops the wine glass.
Alright, goddess chat. Yes, that would be all the sex, then. My subconscious purses her lips in disapproval. I roll my eyes at her, grateful that a certain twitchy palms control freak is not in the room, and resolve to ask him about the personal trainer. That's if I sign. My inner goddess glares at me in desperation. Of course she'll sign. I ignore them both. This actually went with my other quote, so
yeah,
I'm gonna...
It.
I look to my subconscious. She's whistling with her hands behind her back and looking anywhere but me. She hasn't got a clue, and my inner goddess is still basking in a remnant of post... Oh, God. That word.
Post-coital. Yeah, I don't...
Post-coital.
Point-coit.
Still basking in a remnant of post-coital.
So you can do it either, yeah.
I did it, too. It's so bad.
Post-coital.
Wow.
She hasn't got a clue, and my inner goddess is still basking in a remnant of post-coital glow. No, we're all clueless. Things are getting pretty tense in Anna's brain.
I don't know about tense. Just like, duh. Mm.
I guess so.
I want to say that this is American, but we can delete this from the entire podcast if I'm wrong. When she says that she is going to resolve to ask him about the personal trainer, I get what it means. I don't think it'd be impossible that one of us would say that, but like, I resolve to blah! During a time that's not
yeah.
New Year's.
I say that.
I think that's...
I'm the worst.
You are
I say
the worst. Okay. So, Kate...
Oh my god.
The subconscious is likened to Kate, or vice versa. In that, like, oh, Kate would be just like the subconscious personal lips if she had some specs. And my thought was, what could this mean? What does it mean? I guess it doesn't mean anything. Probably nothing, but it was just, yeah, that was one thing I looked at. Obviously this week I was too lazy to handle this, but it seems to me like Anastasia's in control of her faculties in a way that she typically isn't. Like, when she's taking a shower, the inner goddess is like, bleh, you know, because of sex, and the subconscious is just like, hasn't got a clue, whatever. So I think we should lower the level. It's going to be remnant of post-coital glow gray. Now we're going to talk about favorite lines. A man can hope, Anastasia. Dream, even. And sometimes, his dreams come true! That's just a weird line. I laughed when I read it. But my second line, that is obviously the best, is, "Oh, boys and their toys!" Anastasia thinks to herself about Christian.
That reminded me of GoldenEye. I know that's a really common phrase, but Natalia is yelling at, like, Orimov and, at James when they're, like, in the interview. And you just hear, like, "Boys with toys."
He's got right under my skin, literally. I don't know what she means here. And does she mean that he's literally in her vagina, which I guess, but I don't know. That's really weird.
That's still not technically inside of your skin.
Yeah. Well, it could be under.
Christian Grey is literally a scabie.
Also, I didn't notice it till just now, but "he's got right under my skin" is British.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
I think
we'd probably say "gotten."
Oh, yeah. "He's got right under my skin." Yeah, okay. I gotcha.
My favorite line is, "It's shit or bust time."
Good line. For the reasons we discussed.
What was good?
I have a quote that I thought started out really good-ish, and then it became really terrible. So we're gonna read the good part first. "Life in the clouds sure feels unreal. A fantasy. A castle in the air, adrift from the ground, safe from the realities of life. Far away from neglect, hunger, and crack-whore mothers. If she just ended it there, if E.L. James had just ended it there, it would be a good sentence," and then she moved on to Anastasia waking up, but she didn't. She added this: "I shudder to think what he went through as a small child, and I understand why he lives here, isolated, surrounded by beautiful, precious works of art, so far removed from where he started. Mission statement indeed. I frown because it still doesn't explain why I can't touch him." E.L. James, it started out good. That first sentence, those first two sentences, those were okay. But then you just turn it into Anastasia being, like, super immature. I don't like that. Okay, to build on that, the chapter was, like, it was pretty alright. But not really, like, for an erotica novel, I feel like. When you are not writing sex in the interstices between sex having, I believe maybe that you should try a little harder to build tension if that's what you're going for. And I think you should go for that, because typically that's what makes erotica novels better, is if it gets really tense, and then you resolve it by having sex.
I agree.
But anyways, as to speak for what's a little bit more realistic, like, you know, you have sex, it's not like the perfectest afterwards. Got some menial shit going on, like job interviews, and like, whatever, going on a plane, like, I found all those things to be okay. This chapter was not that hard to read.
A lot of the fiction that I write, and enjoy, like, culminates in the sex at the end, and then after that it ends, and everything before that is build up. A lot of times if I find, like, that the sexual tension is sort of broken, they have sex, then everything afterwards is kind of boring. Maybe that's just, like, I'm thinking like a chauvinistic male.
No, I think not. I think that something else has to be introduced for it to be interesting, because if the whole crux of it is just them having sex, then, like, inevitably it has to end after they have sex.
I mean, I guess the stakes are, you know, are they going to stay together to continue to have sex or not?
Yeah, but that's not interesting. What if it was like, what if it was like this? This is why I should write fanfiction. What if you build up to these characters having sex, and then right after they have sex, another dom swoops in and captures the sub and is like, "If you want her back, come fight me in my castle!" Like that.
Oh my god, that exact same thing happened in the book I read.
Oh my god. Oh, that's right! I think you talked about this even. Yeah, that's just one idea, but you need to be able to introduce a continuing tension that isn't lesser than the one you started with. So oftentimes it is good to cut off, or you say that you should cut off. Yep.
Okay, so I think one of the reasons that, like, the last couple chapters have been easier to read is because, unlike at the beginning of the book, Anastasia has stopped, like, reacting to absolutely everything that Christian does, and, like, not everything is so new to her anymore. So we're getting less of her just being like, "Holy fuck," and like, "What's going on?" So it's a lot easier to read, because she's just, like, sort of describing things rather than constantly interjecting her useless thoughts.
I guess the email subjects were okay. Like, they were sort of clever. She was talking about how she was going to go into publishing, and he entitled an email with "Publishing and You," like the title of a pamphlet. that you might find in a guidance counselor's office. And also, he added from his ivory tower to his Christian Grey CEO sign-off thing. That was cute. Also, Anna gives him guff about languages evolving when he's like, that's not a word. So that was good.
Yeah.
Anastasia talked to other human beings. That was good. Not just her and Christian. And it seemed like she's started to gain like a small understanding of how to interact with other people. Though, and I said before, I wonder if she got that sense of dread because her interviewer, Jack Hyde, also wasn't human, and she could just tell that. Mm-hmm. She's starting to comprehend what it's like to be a human, but we have to wonder.
Safe word. Christian offering Anna a job repeatedly is weird to me, and also, like, he kind of sort of threatens her with it as well. I mean, he says it's because she's, you know, capable and smart and all that, but it just seems weird. Like, he's trying to be in charge of another part of her life, mm-hmm. and she's right to be wary, but maybe I'm overreacting.
I don't think so. The quote, one of the quotes in question where he talks about this from an email, where she asks whether Mrs. Jones was ever his, or Miss Jones was ever his sub. I do not employ anyone I've had any sexual relations with. I am shocked that you would think so. The only person I would make an exception to this rule is you, because you are a bright young woman with remarkable negotiating skills. I don't think that Anna is really any of those things except young and woman. Yeah, it's scary. I don't like this. I mean, like, and he's pretending like, oh, like, I would never do that, except I would. Like, all right, dude. My safe word, when Christian gets a little upset with her, or whatever that is, after they have sex, like, there's some moment where he's like, argh, and he's, like, disappointed, and he just, like, pulls out of her, and she winces. Like, that, in, like, this uncomfortable, abrupt way. And, like, I know I have complained about the concept of this before, but when he's doing it as a direct reaction to something that makes him mad, I feel like that's completely unacceptable. Like, I can't excuse that. That's like using somebody's body as like a metaphorical punching bag or taking out a bag. I find it really hard to explain like why it bothers me so much, but just like any sort of like you...
Okay, well, think of it this way. Like, if you stab someone, you want to take your time.
No, that's not at all what I mean.
Getting your knife out.
Here's
slow
the thing.
And intimate.
Like, okay, actually they're having sex, not doing... Anastasia's not being stabbed, so therefore...
That is true.
It shouldn't be, like, a violent act, and yet it becomes something like that when the body is treated in such a way, Anastasia's body. Like, it's... It just, like, it really bugs me a lot. Like, I just... I know, and, like, afterwards he's like, oh, yeah, I made you sore, okay. Like, which is okay. Like, cute. You turned it into something cool. But, like, when you do it, it's like punching a wall when you're angry. Like, a woman is not a wall.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think it's intentional, though. I'm not saying I agree with it, but I think it's definitely supposed to be, like, part of Christian's personality. Mm-hmm. Just, like, doing this sort of stuff.
Just leave him.
It's, yeah, pretty much. Go live your life somewhere else. Move far away from Seattle.
Did you have any, Chen?
Nope.
The nope. Okay. Spoiler right. Dungeon!
Aww.
Yay!
So is Jack Hyde a bad guy? It sure sounds like it, and also I've read ahead, I've, like, looked a little bit, and it sounds like he's a bad guy.
Yeah. He's the major antagonist of book two, and he's a horrendous guy. I'm not gonna spoil it too much. I know this is the spoiler dungeon, but still. I'm sure you can tell by the interview section of the book. I mean, I'm just saying this to you too. Obviously, our listeners are not, like, they don't have to read the book. But if they read this part of the book, you can kind of tell that he's, like, the Christian who could have been. You know, like, he has these deep blue eyes, you know, he cocks his head to the side. He reminds Anastasia a lot of Christian. And, you know, he's boss of the company. So, interesting.
Yes.
Yes, we will be seeing more of him. I put some other questions in here that you guys had brought up during the podcast. Human resource problems. I suppose that, I think Chad said, like, oh, Jack Hyde wouldn't just be saying all this horrible stuff just because some other lady, if the HR lady is, like, literally right there. And the truth is, I think that he's sexually assaulted, pretty much, or not assaulted, but sexually harassed all of the ladies that work at that wow. place. Yeah, it's crazy.
Oh, great.
The last question was the Christian body pin, in which I believe it was again Chad who asked, does he put a pin on his body to indicate where he can and cannot be touched? Where he can and cannot be touched. And my answer is not a body pin. However, they take a tube of lipstick and they draw on him the places where he doesn't want to be touched.
When Chad said it, I thought he was saying a pin.
No, a
lipstick.
To
draw on him.
Oh no, I did say a pin.
Oh,
like
okay.
Pinning it to his clothes.
Oh, I see.
Oh no, I'm sorry. Well, okay, it wasn't a pin,
I was wrong. Yeah. Chad was right about
Cherrydoom,
his own thoughts.
Who was sitting next to me, misheard what I said.
So was the whole button concept correct and the pen concept was not?
Yeah, I said a literal pin.
That's what I thought. I heard it. It's so confusing when people say pin and they mean pen. But it's an accent thing.
You couldn't see this, but I gestured in real life when I said it. Cherrydoom could see it, and she still got it wrong.
Aww.
No, I'm just kidding. She wasn't looking at me, so.
She wasn't looking. Nobody ever looks at me. That's because I don't have a body. I'm Chad. Hi, I'm Chad. No, the other person's not Chad. Don't get confused.
Laters, baby.
Currently, hey. I'm Mommy Space
Princess.
Is it
Laters, baby?
I did.
It's pretty much.
So I'm tired. I don't want to go to bed.
Okay. Yeah, okay. It's Laters, baby. Okay, bye, okay. Everybody.
Laters, baby.
Laters, baby.